Yeah, I mean, a labyrinth, yeah. I mean, I've walked a couple, but not so many. You can do anything with it, right? Traditionally, I think it's done for solitary prayer or meditation. And so what I would do, personally, is I just put my hands together in the position that's used for walking meditation, which is kind of hand in hand or thumb, one thumb in the fists, lightly held fist cup or of the other hand at the chest or at the solar plexus level or a little lower, relaxed, held together. And then the eyes, you know, gaze down a few feet ahead and then do the walking meditation, focusing on, you know, the body movement and the steps and the motion. And then just go from the outside to the inside and the inside to the outside. And then, you know, you could do meditation afterwards. Yeah, that's initial. I mean, you know, I think that the human mind is really unstable by its nature. And instinctively or naturally compares and judges and assesses and measures, and it has many, many functions occurring automatically. You can see maybe yourself, you know, in your own personal mind, how it's very restless, that, you know, I'm everywhere but here. And I think John Lennon said something, you know, in the song, right? The life is what happens when you're busy thinking other things, something like that. Mm-hmm. You know, what happens in front of you is kind of the least of our concerns, because a busy mind is busy with the past or the future. It's a real shame, actually, that the mind is like that. Because, you know, all we have here in terms of a full visceral body, mind, spirit experience is the present moment. I mean, everything is relatively real and everything is relatively dreamlike. But in terms of appreciation of what's in front of us, that is very rare. And there's a certain singularity to being aware in the present moment, including the environment, with an attentive mind. That's mindfulness and meditation, you know. And by that, when there's real clarity in the mind and a fine energy flow, there can be a lot of joy. You know, it's hard to find real joy outside a very strong presence or present moment anchor settlement in the present moment. You know, the experiences of joy that I've had are always very present moment connected, even if they're metaphysical. You know, and a busy mind is really a lot of trouble. And it generally indicates emotional blockage or a blockage of emotional flow. Mm-hmm. And the energy disperses and the mind just becomes overactive. So, yeah, you see, that's direct experiencing, which is very different than just intellectual or theoretical knowing or information, knowledge. You know, to see by yourself, by the doing, how it is you're walking and what, you know, the degree to which you can walk unconsciously or ungrounded, and then making a minor or a subtle shift, how you can feel more grounded and connected to the earth, and it's a different kind of more conscious walking. That just the fact that, you know, you can see the difference between knowing it in your mind and living it. You know, I think there's a line in the Matrix where Morpheus is saying something like, there's a difference between knowing the truth and living the truth, something like that. And, you know, that's in Buddhism, in Zen, there's something called living Zen and dead Zen. Dead Zen is just repeating what the teacher said. taking one's words from theoretical learning rather than direct learning or being present in the moment of the awareness now, which is very alive. You know, each moment is very dynamic, but we're lost in thought, or we're just applying old thought to the present moment. And so walking meditation, I think, is very powerful, and it's done me well during many hard times in life. And I found walking, in Buddhism, they're considered four types of mindfulness. And it's basically mindfulness or present moment awareness in each position of the body, sitting, standing, walking, and lying down. And so sitting is sitting meditation, walking is walking meditation, standing are forms of qigong or tai chi, where there's standing awareness, and lying down is another practice which is also Taoist, which is about moving qi into the lower body and meditative sleep. And those, I think, four stations of mindfulness. Walking meditation is very, very centering, and also it's a very powerful, it's hard to say the word, I'm not sure how I would put it, but introduction of focused awareness that is very practical in daily life, because we're walking all the time. You know, we're either sitting or walking in general, and the sitting cannot be sitting meditation all the time, and we're often busy. Yes, that's right. It's mindfulness of sitting, standing, walking, and lying down. Sitting meditation is, just watching the breath and the hands in their position and the legs folded and whatever. And walking is the awareness of body motion and sound and the footfall. And then lying down is a certain position. The Buddha lie on the right side, and that's considered called the lion's pose. Lying on the right side, the left arm over the right side, over the left side that's up and the right side down, and the right arm is bent, and it's hard to describe. So these four stations of mindfulness, I think the Buddha said something like, if a person could be fully mindful for 7 days in a row, they would achieve full enlightenment. Meaning, it's the power of concentration to detach from the continuing stream of thought and feeling, and the awareness that says, I'm going to be here now. It doesn't matter, just stay here now. Meaning my awareness will stay with the walking or with the sitting or with the breath lying down or with standing. And that's very powerful, cutting off attachment at deep levels. And that's why stuff comes up. Stuff is coming up in a way because it's detaching from the attachment of ordinary unconsciousness, being not conscious of the present moment, keeps our distortions unrecognized. And focusing on the breath, as an example, or the footfall, the steps, is a kind of detaching emotionally from a need to continue engagement in thought. And it's like shining a light in the deep mind, and it just severs attachments or brings up stuff, because there's less of an attachment to them because we're not avoiding it. We're allowing by the focusing on the present moment and the breath or the walking. It's a very subtle thing. And in Theravada Buddhism, you know, that's which done in Thailand and Burma and Sri Lanka, their walking meditation is very well developed, meaning there are many practices, and there are certain teachers that specialize in walking meditation. So when I was in the Thai monastery in New York, in California, San Bruno, actually, the teacher there, who was a meditation monk teacher from Hawaii, has a very small temple, and, you know, he's a real character, but a very wisdom-oriented guy, and a really nice person. You know, he's been a monk for 30 or 40 years, that kind of thing, from Thailand. Taught us an expansion of a certain of walking meditation practice. So the first way is you basically divide your walking into two, and in your mind you're lifting, placing, lifting, placing, meaning you're lifting the left leg and moving forward and placing it. And the second one was lifting, moving, placing, and then there's sort of lifting, turning, placing, stepping, you know, so they basically spread it out into, I think there were ultimately 6 or 7 different stages, where you're, you know, you're aware of the heel going up, and the leg moving forward, and the leg preparing to go down, and the first foot, you know, the ball of the foot going down, and the heel of the foot going down. And that was done with every step. Now, you can get really high or dizzy or spacey or freaked out by that kind of practice because it's cutting very sharply into the normally unconscious stream of walking, of that activity. And so that's a very, and that has to be shown in person. I mean, I couldn't really explain it and I forgot a bit of it, but it's a very profound practice, and sometimes they walk really slowly. So if you go to a Vipassana retreat in America, sometimes they look like dead people. They're like, with their foot, you know, very slowly. To me, it's a little too slow, and Japanese Zen is totally opposite. They have even a running meditation in the temple in the Japanese Zen Rinzai tradition in New York State. Up there in the morning, the first thing was a running meditation. You ran around the zendo on a hallway around it, and then we walked, then it became slower walking, and then we would come in and take our seats and start the morning service. And that was to wake us up at 4 in the morning or 5, whatever. And so there are different ways. So walking meditation, and then also many years ago I was taught, which it's more of an adept practice, where instead of, as you said, instead of walking, instead of placing the foot that's going forward, instead of placing it on the heel, it's not heel walking, it's ball of the foot or front middle foot walking. And that's considered yang, while walking on the heels is considered yin. And a Chinese doctor would also know that because walking on the heels, which many people do, and me too, and all of us sometimes or often, is considered a weakening to the body and a sign of weakness and further weakening, because it's basically like falling backwards versus walking with the front of the foot, the ball of the foot, as you said, which is yang and associated with good health. And there's a way of walking where you don't have your knee, the knees are always bent, meaning that you're not walking straight-legged when you're placing the leg, and you're always walking on the balls of the feet, more or less. And every time, because the knee is bent, the musculature of the whole leg is involved. And when that happens, ultimately you're opening the foot chakras, or you're stimulating the foot chakras, and then more energy comes up the legs. And that's a way of actually strengthening the body as an exercise for actually developing health, gaining better health in walking, by just simple walking. And that's the difference between conscious walking and unconscious walking, which is the norm for us. So this is, you know, this is kind of an advanced discussion. But walking is a very wonderful practice, and changes a lot in the overall awareness, because most of the time we're walking. We're walking or sitting. But any activity requires walking. And if the mind is very familiar with or gets into the habit of counting the steps or doing mantra with a step or simply being aware of the whole body motion and stepping in the walking, it cuts across a lot of mind activity after the walking. It has long-term effects outside, beyond just that time of walking. Yeah, I mean, that's what the adept path involves. The people who are on the adept path, they have many, many practices. And so there are practices of sitting, practices of moving the body while sitting, practices for walking, meditation types, different kinds of things. And so it's about using each minute of the day for developing awareness and freedom from the attachments. So it's a very mature way of seeing daily experience. Yeah. Well, whatever helps to develop greater awareness in the moment. We're normally so unconscious. You know, we have so much going on in the mind. We're not very conscious of what the body is doing in the moment, or we're very preoccupied. And in a certain way, I can see in meditation, just the moment a thought arises, the breathing is disturbed. And that's some disturbance of the natural qi movement, because qi in the body, you know, is accessed by the breathing or developed by the breathing. And thinking represents an obstruction. Actually, thinking itself is a distortion. And that's why Ra said of the Council of Saturn that normally they're in perfect agreement or understanding about every matter they have to handle. But sometimes they're not. And there's some, then there's a need for thought present. When a need for thought is present, then they have a certain conferring. Normally, there's no need for thought. So, it's not that thought is bad. It's just that when there's more clearance in mind or freedom in mind, there's normally less thinking. And that's, you know, in the macrocosm, meaning overall for a person's development, when there's greater wisdom, there's less need for thought. When there's natural understanding or clear perception. Well, things are very subtle. The body-mind interrelation is very, very subtle. I mean, it's not that there are some, you know, a fully enlightened person can be in any body position and they don't lose their freedom. The freedom of mind or being is not lost by body contortion, of course. But body contortion or various postures, as you say, do or can obstruct the flow of energy and lead to reduced awareness, very much so. So it's not like we should always keep a certain position of head or body. That's true. But there are certain body gestures that have somewhat, you know, what Buddhism would call non-skillful. Skillful, non-skillful, not a skillful or positive effect on mind. And so I used to think about in Japan, everybody is bowing their head many times in every conversation. Every time somebody says something significant, the listener is expected to nod or bow a little. And this kind of thing actually interrupts the continuity of thought because they're back, they're up and down and up and down and up and down. There's a certain disturbance. You know, it's like a hammer, a little tapping on the spinal cord, and that jerking it up and down, up and down, up and down, has a negative, you know, harmful effect on centeredness and the ability to think peacefully. And so everybody's nervous there. It makes them nervous. It actually jangles the nervous system. So these things are very subtle. I think there are like 81 signs or 108 signs of the Buddha, meaning there are marks on the body or body conditions, visible forms of body that are associated with the Buddha. There, you could actually Google that, something like signs of the Buddha or marks of Buddha. And it's very true. If you see people, you see teachers who are really developed, their walking is very nice. Or they're walking, you can see their whole being is walking. They're very conscious, and there's great power and grace, as you say. This is a yin and yang, and they're very aware that that's a whole person there, walking. So each thing they do is done with their fuller being, a greater expression of their being. They're not half there. But you know, you can't just wag the tail and to make yourself happy, or follow the, you know, change your manifestation to change your mind. It has some effect, but you know, deep meditation is not just sitting quietly. That doesn't mean the mind has entered stillness or vision. So you don't want to have a hard, you don't want to be rigid about it, okay? But to be more conscious of standing and walking is really helpful without denying any of the mind process, right? It's not about stopping thought, but it's about returning focus to daily, to the body-mind process of walking. So, yeah, I think it is powerful. Sometimes heart arrhythmia is also associated with heart chakra activation. It's said that I read this many years ago, and it was strange, but I think it's probably true, that some big businessmen who die of heart attacks are souls who are activating heart chakra in a big way for the first time, meaning they're responsible for hundreds of people, and they're not used to that challenge as a soul, and they're trying to get onto the positive path, and they can't quite do it, and there's heart activation and blockage, and then the heart conks out. Yeah, I mean, the key is to find the practices that work. You know, a practice that you like and a practice that has, that feels right, and then doing it and seeing the result. Now, the idea of breathing, coordinated with walking, has, you know, opponents and proponents. So there are people who would teach meditation that you should never coordinate with breathing, and there are others who would teach that you should always coordinate, like you're saying. So you got to kind of be clear about that. Personally, I don't want to coordinate my breathing with my walking, because I'd rather let the breathing be natural and focus on the walking. But again, there are many, many options. So if somebody gives you a teaching and it doesn't seem right, you can understand that there's probably an opposite practice that could be just fine. Yeah, you have to be careful with modern Western forms of Buddhist practice and teaching, or theory and practice, because there have been a lot of things that have been watered down and really, I think, complexified or complicated for the Westerner. who's assumed to be hyper-neurotic. The assumption is that the Westerner is a total mess, and they need baby practices because they're totally unconscious, or they're totally neurotic and filled with self-conflicting thought, which is often the case. But some of those practices, I think, actually keep people become stuck in their practices. Absolutely. And so if the walking is a very special or complicated technique or artificial or very unnatural, then you can't do it in daily life. Meaning you can only do it in the temple or when nobody's watching you because you look crazy. And also it's harder to integrate into the normal way of walking or being when it's a highly specialized practice. And so you see, the thing is that the practice itself is not important. What's important is that the practice is working. And that's why there are a zillion practices, because different techniques are suited differently to different people. So a person who's naturally more young, more active, shouldn't be thrown into a hyper slow walking practice. They'll freak out. And it may not even be necessary. The key is not to be slow. The key is to be free. And the practice is then a matter of concentration and being able to quiet by one-pointedness or by concentration on the technique. That's all. And many, many people are attached to technique and they think it's a big deal. I remember I was sitting in one temple and or somewhere, and I had learned in 1980 from the guy who was he was an American who was a monk in Sri Lanka, Jay. I lived in Chicago, and he taught student course in Oberlin when I learned the first time formally. And it was left hand under right hand in the sitting position, right? So my right hand rests in my left palm, and my thumbs are tip to tip above it, you know, making a little circle, a little round there. Typical Zen position. And I was sitting in some retreat sometime, and some young monk or assistant came around, reached his arm in front of me in the meditation, and put my right hand under my left hand. Because he had been taught that. Completely unaware of of the condition of my mind, right? I could have been in samadhi and in great expansion or awareness, but he felt it was necessary to put the other hand, so to reverse the holding position of the hands, because he thinks that's important, and he's wrong. But there are many white people who become like that. They just apply their neurosis to the practice. So, I mean, in the end, the point is to, you know, I think Dogen, the Japanese Soto Zen teacher, said something like, the practice of Zen is to study the self. And to study the self is to forget the self. And to forget the self is to, something like to become one, to realize being one with all. Which is, you know, unity, higher self, late 6D, right? Six chakra. So Buddhism understands, you know, the Buddha himself, again, didn't talk about unity. So you see, it's very complicated. You have the original teachings, which are Theravadin, or as close as they can get, are shown in Pali, P-A-L-I, Pali literature, what the Theravadins use. It's what you see at the insight meditation groups, Vipassana groups. And there's no talk of unity. And there's no real positive definition of enlightenment. But then you've got Mahayana, which is then what you got into in Vietnam and China and Japan. And forget about Tibet, that's a whole other story, because they added a whole other tradition, the indigenous shamanic. So then you've got these people in Japan and China who are doing their own thing too. And particularly in Japan, they veered off the original teaching. And so they're talking about unity. But the Buddha didn't talk about unity. Unity is just a thought, actually. It's a reality. It's the thought that expresses a reality which is not encompassed by the thought of unity. And the experience of unity is not a final destination. It's a stage of awakening. Because complete and perfect enlightenment, there's a transcendence of attachment to consciousness. Not only dualistic consciousness, but consciousness itself. Consciousness itself is recognized as an illusion or ignorance. So the Buddha said, even consciousness is born of ignorance. And that's what we talked about last week in Ra, where Ra is talking about the infinity of consciousness versus the infinity of spirit. The infinity of consciousness is basically a higher self unity, late 60. The infinity of spirit is infinity, or fusion, or, I am that I am. Beyond, it's basically in the infinite, ineffable, intelligent infinity. So you have, and then the teachings that were developed, that were later modified by guys 500 years ago, 200 years ago, the Mahayana, which is 2,000 years out from the Buddha, 2,500 years ago. The Buddha is 2,500 years ago. And so 2,000 years later, or 1,000, 1,500 years later, you've got all this Mahayana talk, much of which is added by them and off the original teaching. And then you've got the what's developed for the white people and the Westerners in America and Europe, which itself is a further modification. And much is lost, And they have many people, like in the Vipassana community, have a real hard time with karma, with past lives, with reincarnation even, with higher dimensions, with asuras, with the teachings of mysteria or multidimensional reality that the Buddha was second, it was no big deal, right? The devas visited the Buddha every night for teaching. So many Westerners have a hard time with all that. And so there's even this movement Buddhism without metaphysics, non-religious Buddhism becomes a psychological practice. That's not Buddhism. That's a modification. So if you're really serious, you have to cut through that too. So you have to cut through the adaptations that were done for Westerners, and then you've got to actually cut through the additions that were made by the Mahayanists. If you really want to know what the Buddha was teaching, which was extremely simple, the original practice of breath meditation was not even counting. It was just knowing the in-breath, knowing the out-breath, and knowing the quality of the in-breath, and knowing the quality of the out-breath, and knowing the space or knowing the condition of one's being in the space between breaths. That's it. It didn't even say sit in this position and put your hands this way, because everybody knew that. But it was basically it was a tremendous streamlining of previous Hindu practices into the goal of pure non-obstructed awareness in the present moment as the means of liberation. And then insight, liberating insight, comes naturally, so that there's no separation between shamatha vipassana or samadhi, concentration and insight. When concentration gets to a certain level, if you don't go into a trance and you continue with the body mind awareness in the moment, even if it's very very subtle, naturally insight is quite available. But this, most people are using, they use Buddhism as some kind of alternate psychology therapy, which is fine, but it's much more than that, and it's really not specifically that. that's just a part of what the effects are, or usage. Any comments on this? Well, it's not like ballerina walking, you know, but that's really the tiptoes. It's walking on the soft part. I mean, what, I don't know the term ball of the feet. I use it, but I'm not sure if it's accurate. No, it's the front middle, the upper middle of the sole. You know, there's the heel, and then there's the arch, and then there's the balls of the feet. I think it's in between those. That's where the chakra is, actually. Or that's one entry point for energy. So it's basically forward walking. It's not walking like leaning backwards on your heels, like a bung. I make noise, but it doesn't express it. But it's sort of some birds walk that way, where they're walking on the, they seem to be leaning forward. It's a little bit like that. And the Taoists know about that very well. The Taoists, Chinese Taoists, many Qigong practices are modeled after animals, animal movement. Many. And that's why our friend Li Ching Yuen said something like, what did he say? Something like, sleep like a dog, walk like a bird, walk like a pigeon, sit, walk like a pigeon, sleep like a dog, sit like a turtle. Something like that. And the guy lived to be 250 years old. Yes, actually. That kind of walking, or walking on the fronts, you know, the balls of the feet, moving, you know, placing the footfall, directing the footfall to the front of the sole of the foot, between the balls. That is associated with running, you know. Running, nobody runs on their heels, right? Heel walking is basically as one step before falling backwards. So front of the foot walking, this sort of, I don't know, there's maybe a better word than balls of the foot walking, but that walking on the front, similar to running, actually you can feel, I've had these experiences where I could feel one column of energy, or the unified energy from the balls of the feet up through the middle of the body, up through the viscera, as you say, that intestine. That's exactly the key. And there's a Taoist understanding that the Taoist breathes from the ball, from the tips of the toes. He breathes from from his feet, from his toes. And that can be experienced when the channels are open. Because when the channels are open, then there's an uninterrupted flow, or better, increased flow from the toes or the middle of the foot up through the whole torso. That's just what happens. And that then is a healing to the middle. So the viscera of the body are healed by that kind of walking. So very interesting. And that's what you're saying. And that's what that's the Taoist way, which is that every motion, or ordinary motions of body are used as practice to strengthen the qi and also develop the mind, concentration. So any Taoist practice, like standing meditation with a certain tai chi position without walking, or walking and lying down, all of these, when the position is right and the technique is understood, can be used for meditation. And so the focusing on the breathing, or focusing on the walking, is then the mindfulness practice, while the technique, the proper gestures of the body are done, and body and mind are thereby strengthened. The body by the qi development, or the correct proportion, or you know, the right positioning, where the arms are, where the legs are, where the foot falls, where the body is resting, where the arms go, and the hands, and the hand position, whether the thumb and the first finger are together, or whatever that may be. oh, that all that strengthens body, and then the focus on that becomes the mindfulness practice, becomes the meditation. And so that's how this guy lived to be 250 years old. And there's, you know, we said this in the second paragraph of the biography on the Wikipedia page. He says, his master said that his longevity, quote, is due to the fact that I perform the exercises every day, regularly, correctly, and with sincerity for 120 years. That's the way to do it. And that is a person who seriously wants perfect health and mental development. Everybody wants good health, but most of us don't want it enough to make that degree of effort. And the so-called ego or personal self process is also surrendered because, as he's saying, there is the need for regular practice, which means it doesn't matter how you feel, you do it. And correctly, meaning you may like it one way, but that's called incorrect. It's not do whatever you want, hey man, we're happy here. That's not what we're talking about. Same thing with Buddhist technique, Buddhist meditation. There is a correct and there is an incorrect. But but it's not, it's, you know, whether the right hand is up or down is less important or not at the heart of correct or you know, required positioning. It does mean something, but it's a little different. So same thing with walking slowly, walking quickly. It's not the speed that's most important. It's the degree of mindfulness brought to it and the understanding of what the mind does. When you're sitting there, what is your mind doing? When you're following your breath, what are you doing? And so this is very Taoist, meaning the heart or spirit here is Taoist. He understands the practice has to be done regularly, yeah, every day or many hours a day. That's how he lived to be 200 plus. And correctly, meaning there is a wrong way. And sincerity, meaning you have to really want it, not pretending. And throw yourself into it, which means some days you feel lousy, but you sit there and you do your practice feeling lousy. Fine. You know? I hate meditation, and I'll do it anyway because I'm here for the long haul. That kind of thing. Meaning I feel lousy today, but I'm going to do it anyway. So it's a certain disciplined attitude, and that's how achievement is done. And you know, the discipline can come by sincerity, or it always comes by sincerity, meaning there's the discipline that is applied top down, like, I know this is right and I must do it. I don't want it or I don't like it, but I must do it. Sometimes that's okay, but as an overall attitude, it's a problem, because in the end, the person hasn't taken care of the degree to which they don't want to do it. And so at some point, the person will follow that and stop the practice and maybe stop for a long time. So forcing is a problem. there's the sincerity that comes, or the discipline that comes from need. And the sincerity, a sincere practice by need. And that can be more of a emotional pain, but the person will throw themselves into it because their life depends on it. Yeah, no, I mean, you know, the question of sincerity is, first of all, it's a very, very important word in Chinese philosophy, sincerity. I think the word is jen, something, one of those words that are hard to pronounce. And it's considered one of the highest virtues, sincerity. Sincerity basically is a love-wisdom blend because it's honest and it's heartfelt. So it's honest and heartfelt intentionality. My intentions are true or sincere, honestly and from the heart. And that's one of the ideals of Taoism and Confucianism. And a lot of people, you know, want to be sincere but have mixed feelings about things and then snuff out or repress, suppress the counter feeling. Like, I know I should, like you're saying, sincerity coming from understanding deeply the whys. That can help, but people have to, you have to also give some true, some honor or some attention to my disliking of what's good for me. I know it's good for me, but I don't want to do it. Okay. I sincerely admit that I have ambivalence. I sincerely acknowledge that I'm tired or it's painful to continue. So it's a real, and that's sincerity too. You know, there's a sincerity in not wanting to do what we know is good for us and wanting to persist in not doing what's good or doing what's not good for us, right? I know it's not good for me, but I really can't stop myself, meaning I still want it. And that has to be gently moved through over a time, over a while perhaps, the opposition to what's good for us. I don't want to admit the truth. I don't want to accept this. That too has to be met sincerely. But this is a guy who had a lot of time to study and learn. And so just those three words shows that he knows what he's doing, saying regularly, correctly, and sincerely, with sincerity. Each of those is important. And, you know, the traditional teaching is a few words that are all very important. And the modern teaching is many words, many of which are not important. That humor is the overcomplexity of the Western mind, but actually often leads to greater complexity. Like if you look at people involved in Tibetan Buddhism, man, their mind is busy, 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 filled with Tibetan Buddhism and theory and practice and different teachings and the 500 initiations and this puja and that practice and that technique. You know, that's not the point, to be filled with doctrine, the mind filled in doctrine. That's not real freedom. So you have to transcend the medicine also. Yeah, you see, it's very common that Westerners particularly egotize their practice. They basically think about their practice as another way of strengthening their sense of self. And so I'm doing a special practice because I'm a senior student and I got those secret initiations. Or I'm doing this practice and it's advanced because I'm superior. Or this is the right practice and everything else is not right. Technique is just technique. Ross said, begin and end in the Creator, not in technique. And any advanced Buddhist teacher would know that it's the transformation of awareness and freedom from attachment that is the key. Technique is actually not necessary. There are guys, adepts, who got awakened by hearing, you know, a sound, by hearing one teaching, with having not spent time in practice. So, Well, there are many cases in the history of Buddhism, particularly in China and Japan, where guys had a satori or an awakening experience based on wrong practice. They were saying the mantra wrong or doing something wrong according to proper technique, and they still had satori. I mean, there's a case, and maybe this is a fake, but I was told by the teacher, Edo Roshi, that there was a Japanese teacher called Bobo Roshi. Bobo means fucking. And the idea was, you know, in Japan, they really do their own thing. So he was a monk and did lots of practice, I guess, and went to a brothel, and you know, which is completely against the rules, which they do freely often, and had a satori right there in the middle of sex. And another guy had a satori in the shower, feeling the hot water after a cold, being in the cold Japanese winter zendo. So the technique is very much, it's a means to an end. And each technique very much does focus on different aspects of the mind. Meaning, some people will find it easier to walk fast and others find it easier to walk slow. And the one that prefers fast walking, like me, not that fast, but I prefer a normal speed, would have more trouble with a slower practice. And those who are fast or slow might have more trouble with a faster practice. And so the one who is very comfortable with a certain technique would be given the opposite technique or a different technique by their teacher to, you know, bring forth their resistance and their blockages that wouldn't come up with the preferred technique. So there is a value to doing the technique you don't like, because stuff comes up there. On the other hand, technique is not the point of practice, or practice is not the point of practice. The goal of practice is not proper practice or proper technique. It's a transformation of awareness or freedom from illusion. And it's also freedom from self-conceit or self-cherishing, or what we call ego, which Ra says is just a concept associated with third chakra blockage. Without third chakra blockage, that concept will not be believed in, the concept of ego. And so, and after a first level enlightenment, also the student realizes there's no ego. They're not free from distortion, but they are aware that self is a dream, or self is not solid. Self is a non-localized, non-dual presence, which is awareness, right? You know, intelligent infinity is the one infinite creator, which is all. That's what we are too. And that is, can be experienced as non-dual awareness, which is non-self-referentiality, or no longer self-referencing, me, which we always do. So the great advance of Buddhism over Hinduism was a direct pointing to the goal as being freedom from self-referencing. Because even great yogis, or great Buddhist teachers too, you know, they're not necessarily totally free, have a big, big self, you know. It's called the spiritual materialism. It's spiritual inflation. It's a sense of identification with a greater awareness and power, conceived of as a separate self. So I'm doing advanced practices. I've had, you know, satori experiences. I know this and that. And so that's the problem with certain techniques that are very control-oriented, like pranayama, particularly pranayama, actually, because pranayama is very much like me. I must do this, and then I must do that, and then I must do the next thing. So it's a continual series of self-generated actions, which doesn't yield to surrender very easily, because there's a continual need to continue checking whether I'm doing the right thing, and how many seconds have I held my breath now, and have I visualized correctly. And so then the technique is very complicated, and most people get stuck in it, and it strengthens their delusional false identity, or their conceit, their sense of self, sense of separated self. Like that lady, you know, I'm doing the advanced practice because I don't need the early practice because I'm superior. Well, that's a person who will just strengthen the belief in ego. Their false belief in ego will be strengthened by their practice. And that's how a black magician is born. So the original teaching of practice from the Buddha himself was really, really simple. So simple that actually almost no modern person can do it, because it's not about a complicated performance of activity in the practice. It's simply focusing on awareness, moment to moment awareness, knowing the body mind process moment by moment, focused on the breath. That's it. Nothing else. And what modern people will hit is their vast neurosis, normally, which is emotional blockage, which is a lot of pain and restlessness arising in the mind. And you have to go through that, actually. But if you keep sitting and sitting and sitting, or doing the practice and surrendering to the flow of painful thought and feeling, and let it come, let it go, and back to the breath, let it come, let it go, and back to the breath, or asana, the reservoir will drain. The reservoir, these are the distortion leavings of the adept path that Rod talked about. The stuff that comes up in practice are distortion leavings. And there has to be, if the practice is too complicated, and too much involved in self-referencing, then the person will not be able to allow those distortion leavings to pass out. We all do. You may have fewer than you think. It's just that you see them very clearly. You know, if I hold my hand 2 inches from my face, is it right to say the world is a hand? My hand is enormous. But if I put my hand of, you know, I stretch out my arm and I look at my hand, I say it's a hand. It's just a hand, right? Not a big thing. But if I put it 2 inches to my face, it's enormous, and the whole world is a hand now, and this hand is monstrous. But it's just that I'm very close to it. Not that it itself is so big. And so in meditation and practice like this, we see our distortions very clearly up close and personal, and they seem monstrous often, but they're not. It's just that our awareness is very focused on them. The people who have huge distortions are those who haven't even started the game yet. They're not even in the ballpark. So have a good evening or day. And take good care. See you soon. Okay. Bye-bye.